Hey, how's it going? I'm Ida Golden and welcome to my vlog. Okay, so we are going to be talking about a couple of related things today. The Dismitus, the Calcacue, the Tayin and the Dimapitayin. And there is a reason that I've grouped them all together, because they have certain things in common. So we will start off with the Dismitus and the Dimapitayin, and as I sort of explain kind of what they are, you'll kind of get why sort of grouping them together. Most of my multiverse notes are on the Dismitus and the Calcacue. I was hoping I'd have clarification as to which way round the Dimapitayin and the Pitayin was supposed to go. But I am fairly certain the Dimapitayin came first, because I'm pretty sure it's D&D. That's all I'm sure of. So this may be one of those things that when I do the corrections video or the additions video at some point, I may have to correct, and so you'll just reverse the Dimapitayin and the Pitayin part in that video. But I'm pretty sure I've got it the right way around, because I'm pretty sure I went with Dean and D, so that in my head I would remember it better. So what are the Dismitus and the Dimapitayin? Well, they are both classed as being one-offs in the multiverse. As in, if a Dismitus or a Dimapitayin is born, there's either a very limited number of them born throughout the multiverse, or they are literally the only one born in the multiverse. The Dismitus, much more so than the Dimapitayin, Dimapitayin can, to an extent, have a few more variations with floating around the multiverse, but they're usually linked within a circle. They are very much believed to be children of the gods. The Dismitus, specifically, because they tend to be found on their own, in the middle of nowhere with no clear parentage. Whereas the Dimapitayin tend to sort of, not necessarily virgin birthes, but the idea is that there is no clear secondary parent for said child. So that's one of the first sort of differences between the Dismitus and the Dimapitayin, is that Dimapitayin tend to have at least one clear mortal parent, whereas the Dismitus don't, but they are both believed to be somehow descended from the gods. And like I said, they're both limited in their numbers, but throughout the multiverse, they're not like, you know, your standard person who might have hundreds or thousands of variations of themselves spread throughout the multiverse. They tend to be very limited in number. I know I'm repeating myself a little bit, I'm sorry. So the Dismitus are sort of believed to be associated with the Odraeans or the Kaosen. A lot of them were first found within the Kaosen sort of era, and then very much more into the Odraean era, where you get the sort of the bulk of them. This is sort of pre the birth of the Silconians, at the point in time that the Silconians come into existence and have their mass evolution, the Dismitus do stop showing up. Whereas the Dimapitayin, on the other hand, are very much associated with the standing, and they tend to be within the standing groups, and they sort of start showing up around the time the Silconians come into existence, and they sort of keep going for a good couple of millennia after the disconnection as well. And this is the equivalent across all the multiverses, so even though not all, sorry, all the realms and all the realities, so even though I'm using the Circle of Six's timeline to sort of key in when these sort of things kind of occur, it's just because you guys have a vague understanding of the Circle of Six and their sort of timeline. I know I haven't gone into huge details with it, but it's a timeline you guys, I'm hoping, will sort of understand. Maybe. You at least get that these are sort of key events that affected the multiverse as a whole. So what makes a Dismissus a Dismissus and not just an abandoned child? As I've explained before in the Odraean vlog, the Odraeans are single elementalists, whereas Dismissus are full elementalists. They tend to also have a few other little abilities, some which are common to all and some which are only within, you know, certain Dismissus, which sort of set them apart a little bit, which are, you know, they make them appear to be more than just your average mortal, which, you know, if you're thinking this is a divine being or from divine origins, then you kind of want some sort of reason to be thinking it. So, as I said, they're full elementalist opposed to the single elementalist Odraeans. And they have a few other abilities which sort of set them apart. I won't go into too much depth into what those abilities are, because I don't know what all of them are, to be honest. The sort of key one that is sort of mentioned in the multiverse canon that I have open next to me, as you can see I keep bouncing towards it again, is the blue ice ability, which is to do with reproduction. But that is something I think should maybe get talked about in its own sort of separate one, if at all. It's not that I don't enjoy sort of talking about it, it's just, you know, I'm trying to keep these a little bit more concise now, and I don't want to go onto this big, huge, long tangent. So yeah, that's what sort of distinguishes the Demoptane, not the Demoptane, the Dismissus, and how the Dismissus sort of work and why they get this sort of status sort of thing. And then on the other hand, you've got the Demoptane, and they don't necessarily show as much inclination towards being divine. A lot of it can be sort of more up to interpretation than anything else. But they do tend to have this charisma about them that sets them apart, and they have this ability to get people to listen to them and to their ideas, and yeah, there is definitely something distinct about the Demoptane that do sort of set them apart from your average mortal. So even if, you know, you can argue, you know, they've definitely got two mortal parents, these are their mortal parents, what are you talking about? There is something unique and something special about them. And on the Demoptane side, again, as I said, tends to be a limited number of them, so when you look at that individual across the entire multiverse, then you can kind of see why they're sort of marked out as being a bit special, but within the realm and the reality in which they sort of are raised and grow up, and they're not necessarily aware that they are fairly unique within the multiverse. There is definitely something special about how they act and how they interact with other people that does sort of set them apart, even if they don't necessarily have anything magically different about them. There is definitely something unique and distinct enough about them which tends to garner them a bit of a following and tends to make them uniquely special to the standing, if to nobody else. And this is sort of why they get this sort of status. Whether they deserve this sort of status or not is debatable, much more so than with the Dismissus, who show clear signs of, you know, why they are special, why they are different. But yeah, they very much The way of thinking about it is that the Dismissus and the Demon Pitain are basically two sides of the same sort of coin for two different groups. So that now brings us on to the Calicacu and the Pitain. The Pitain are descendants of the Demon Pitain. So like the Demon Pitain before them, it means there's probably a limited number of them throughout the multiverse. Doesn't mean that they'll be completely unique in the same way, because as I sort of mentioned with the whole Senkining, you don't necessarily need the same parentage to exist as a version of, or for a version of you to exist within a different reality. The kining process isn't quite as strict as that, as it were. But there are probably going to be less numbers of you than there would necessarily be of others, because obviously there is a certain, you know, limit to how often something that is limited to begin with can then reoccur again. But as I said, there are going to be a greater number of them, and they're going to be across a greater number of realities, because, you know, Senkining isn't an exact science. It's most certainly not an exact science. Don't ask how or why it's not an exact science. It kind of should be, considering it's working on genes and DNA and all that kind of stuff, but no. My multiverse, my rules. So yeah, like the Demon Pitain before them, they do tend to have this way about them where they can sort of draw people to them. It's not necessarily as strong, it's not necessarily as distinct. It's definitely there. They're definitely more unique than your average, but a lot less unique than the Demon Pitain that sort of came before them. So then, on the other hand of that, you've got the Calicacu. And I know there are a lot more distinctions between the Calicacu. Without the Calicacu, the Silconians pretty much would not exist. That is definite. Obviously, the Calicacus are descended from the Dismitus in the same way that the Pitain are descended from the Demon Pitain. Calicacus normally have heightened abilities. They are prone to visions, and they are also prone to being possessed by other beings. In the last vlog, I talked about the static frequency shield and how it sort of protects people, and the stages that you go through, you know, the various stages of the shield protection. Calicacus have their own different kind of shield. Active when it's definitely active, when they know that it's active. There's Calicacu unknown when it is unclear whether that person is active or not, because nothing has sort of come across to sort of do anything. And I think it's Calicacu unactive when the shield is actually working as it should. And it's bit random as to who will and who won't. It has much, because it's not like a complete, it's not like they've become a nether. It's more like they're sort of at the under nether sort of stage, where they've got that sort of 50% sort of protection. And it's a little bit more complicated than that again, because they can't be, they have a lot more strength to them, a lot more ability to sort of fight these things off, but it tends to have a greater strain on their mental health, obviously. So being an active Calicacu opposed to a non-active Calicacu is not necessarily the greatest thing in the world, and these terms are probably amongst some of the things that I may need to correct. I know it's definitely active. My multiverse canon is definitely telling me active is correct for what I'm saying, but the other terms might not necessarily be right. The whole Calicacu thing is, as I said earlier, without the Calicacus you wouldn't get the Silconians, because Most of your Zirconians are Kalkakis, but they are mostly either unknown or inactive. There are very few lines that tend to have active Kalkakis within them. The Ashmars get a predominant amount of active Kalkakis, whereas the Lutonis tend to have a lot less active Kalkakis, which kind of balances out quite well, because the Lutonis tend to take it upon themselves when the ruling Ashmar is a active Kalkaku to take on a lot of the burden and take on a lot of the responsibility and aid their Ashmar as best they can, and they tend to, you know, amongst the better ones for sort of dealing with it, because they are the least likely to themselves be active. Kalkakus can access some of their inherited Desmitis abilities without becoming an active Kalkaku and having that sort of negative effect of it. But it's all sort of complicated, and I'm a little bit on the muddy side, as it were. So, yeah. The Desmitis basically came about so that the Zirconian evolution could happen. even though, like, mostly the realms and realities that you get Desmitis, you don't then get the Zirconians, probably partly because those particular Desmitis didn't procreate and have Kalkaku. Not that those realms are necessarily completely free of Kalkaku, but it's the predominance. The Circle of Six probably had more Kalkaku than any of the other realms, which then allowed for the sudden mass evolution phenomenon to happen, because you had that precursor there, that sort of genetic precursor there. I'm not quite sure what else I can say on the subject of the Kalkaku, the Desmitis, and the Dimopitan and the Pitan. I hope I've sort of explained it okay. The easiest of topics to sort of cover, because it's sort of, there's a lot of it and not that much of it at the same time. So now I have to decide what I'm going to be talking about next time, don't I? I think next time I want to do a little bit of a corrections vlog. Not for any... a corrections and addition vlog. Because there are definitely a couple of things I know from some of my earlier ones that I haven't got 100% correct. And I think it would be good to sort of go over a few of those details and sort of iron them out a little bit, maybe. So, yeah. That'll probably be a short one. and will hopefully be an okay-ish one. Alright. I hope to see you guys again next time. And until then, see ya.